You ready, Carter?
I'm set.
Little dap.
Where's BT Brock Boy 10 Spear on his way?
I mean, nice! Yeah.
Damn it.
Ooh, that was good.
Did you have your weed?
I like that.
Right, cap, yeah, baby.
Have a good one.
Tonight. Yeah.
Happy birthday.
I'll be like 3 weeks.
Sir.
We have Tinsley coming. He's good.
Oh, good. Let's go grab our girl.
Yola.
Ah!
He is. What's up, baby? Hi, baby. How you doing today? So
there's sort of been a separation between recorded music and our live performance. Things change a lot on stage, night to night and week to week. We're not playing to promote anything but the show that we're doing, you know? But the show's been, from the beginning, sort of been our center, the part that's kept us going. There's a freedom on the stage. I was talking to Jeff Coffin, who's the most recent addition. He was saying to me the other day that he's never been in a band that's so open. I like keeping it loose because it keeps it exciting for me. I become part of the audience because the music is different every night. That openness makes it sort of much more playful.
We get out there and we have fun with it, and we get out there and we make sure that what we're doing is gonna touch that audience in such a way that they're gonna leave and be like, holy, what was that?
Dave puts everything into the music.
What he can do playing guitar and singing is pretty remarkable.
Dave has a certain energy, that frontman energy that we need.
He's not a showy vocalist. Like, there are vocalists that are very melismatic, singing a lot of notes off of one tone. And Dave can move around like that because he's got really good control of his voice.
Still to this day, just a magical, just beautiful voice that's unmatched by anybody.
When he gets on stage, you know, that nervous energy is there, but I think we need that. But Dave, he tackles that in such a way that it's like, okay, take that. Let's go out here and kick some butt.
Up there is a pretty remarkable violin player. He's also a remarkable stage presence. He's unique. There's something about it comes across as pretty modern, but it's a really primitive way that he approaches that instrument, a really honest way.
I just always worry that he's going to fall off the stage when BT starts a solo. He's got dark sunglasses, and I don't know how he does it, but he gets right up to the edge, and he goes. It's something very unique. I don't think there's another fiddle player on the planet that plays the way he does. If the band was kind of feeling a little drowsy and maybe we just needed something, let's give BT a solo. You can't help but just like,
He'll wake the house up and he'll get out front and he'll do his dance and he'll do his violin thing and get to stomping and twisting, and he's feeling it, you know, and we're feeling it too.
If I'm really there, I don't know it. You know, I don't realize what's going on. I'm just in there just rocking it, you know what I mean? I'm just standing in that moment, and you know, and then after the fact is like, I might go, oh, that was cool, you know?
Stefan is my right arm. We have to lock so hard together to keep the foundation so the other guys can make a statement. When we played the other night, he did something that I just wanted to jump off the drums and just start screaming because it was so incredible.
You were doing bad. That was nasty. That was nasty.
Yeah.
Stephon brings that sort of youthful element to the band, you know what I mean? It's just like he's from the skater generation and so forth, and you know, and that's really cool to have that.
Having Tim back, Tim Reynolds on guitar, he's been playing on and off with us a lot, and I played with him for years, obviously. Tim brings this ability to be immediate and conversational in music, no matter how big the audience is or how unusual the music is.
I can't believe sometimes I'm like in this band, I'm playing here with Tim Reynolds, who growing up was like, you know, this amazing virtuoso musician.
That's Mr. Tim Reynolds on the guitar.
Rashawn was always reluctant to solo. He's doing it more now. He's stepping out more, spreading his legs out a little bit and blasting his trumpet. But at first, he just wanted to sort of fit in.
When Leroy started having Rashawn come out, that he liked about Rashawn is he was just himself behind the horn.
When Roy was injured, we brought another horn player in. Roy had, with Rashawn, had created this sort of section sound that we'd all started to really get excited about. That when Roy left, we said, well, the one thing we can keep that Roy had brought is this section sound. So that was really the motivation behind getting another sax player, was to maintain a sound that Roy had created.
Jeff Coffin is outrageous. He had to fill some pretty damn big shoes.
A lot of the fans know the music better than I do. I've had to put in, even before the tour started, about a month and a half solid of only working on this stuff.
He's had to learn a lot of music, and not only like lines, but the way the lines were played, the intensity.
Now that Jeff's been out on stage with us for a while, he brings a really different energy, and I think the openness that the band had started to feel for each other again before Roy's accident has allowed us to be open to a really different player. Jeff's brought a really unique voice. Carter and I have a relationship on stage that is powered by what he can do. I don't think there's a lot of musicians in the world on any instrument that can play as explosively and as powerfully as he can.
Carter, you know, obviously is the powerhouse. He's like the rocket engine. He's got the energy, and when he's on fire, you can't help but to just hold on.
I try and be more or less the cheerleader, you know, for the guys, to a degree that allows everybody to just to step the game up, you know, another level.
That was okay, right?
That was excellent.
Man, I had my ears out, so I couldn't tell. If he's really positive, everybody else feels that strength and feels like there's a captain that is worth following. I would say that on stage, Carter is absolutely the captain. It's really unbelievable to watch him play. I've never seen a drummer that can move a crowd just by himself, just move it. People can't believe what they're seeing because you can't, it's unbelievable. And in the middle of all that, it'll blow a bubble. One thing about that I think is unique about this band is you don't have to fit any dimensions or stylistic boundaries to fit into the band.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
all really dig this album. You know what I mean? It's, to us, it feels like an album, like one of the first albums we did, like Under the Table and Crash. It's that same kind of excitement. We kind of like went back to the very beginning, you know, of the way that we used to start, which is like in Dave's mom's basement, you know, all together, like writing songs together.
We've been working on this for about a year, but it's been 4 years since a record. I think we just all knew that whatever happens, we have to make this record together. And it has to be a record that we're 100% behind, each one of us.
There's some great stuff in that card.
Shoot, yeah, card. Yeah, it felt good. Yeah, that was tight. Can we do it again? Is everybody cool for that? Yeah. I know it's late, but I'm starting to feel a little taste here.
I don't care.
We brought in Rashawn and Jeff, who are with us playing trumpet and saxophone. Oh, yeah.
Maybe go, I mean, it's not that, but they maybe just fire, into something that's exciting from there. You know? Yeah. Okay. There you go. That, I like that.
Yeah. Right. So, and I'll go. And Tim was with us when we recorded Under the Table and Crash and Before These Crowded Streets.
What we had at the beginning was we had this eagerness. We knew we had something that was like nothing else. Audiences were enjoying it, but man, we couldn't clean the toilets in at a festival or South by Southwest, man. They'd be like, hell no, you can't come down here. But then, you know, then there was a few records where we kind of, you know, I think, like I say to Carter, we went on a little bit of a holding pattern, you know, just, and that was faith. I think that was faith in what we were doing as well. Mm-hmm. But we just kind of lost connection with each other. You know, I think we all kind of bottomed out, kind of had a, kind of came to a head at a point. But then, you know, good friendships and good management. We worked out. We got into a room together and sort of punched it out. And that sort of started happening in the last few years. We started seeing that we needed to do that again. And you know, I'm glad to say Roy is one of the people that instigated this new. This change, changing himself, changing us.
You know what I like, Dave? I hate to say this. I like the other part to end on, man. The part that comes, I don't know what you call it on.
Right before that part.
What are you talking about?
That's what I like. I think it's better, because I think it's better. Shorter.
It's a little bit more, it makes it a little less predictable.
Yeah.
You know.
The music started feeling it live, you know? It started happening live. The music started changing again. There started being aggression. We got Tim back in, and there's a whole lot of things started happening around what is giving the sort of the birth of this new record.
Been a rebirth in a way, and Roy was there for the rebirth. This hasn't happened since his death. This was happening before he passed, and I think that's continuing. His death has maybe amplified how together I feel and how close I feel to the other guys in the band. Really, Roy's passing has really made me understand how important it is to enjoy every minute on stage with the guys.
In the studios, like Rory was always behind me in the booth behind me. So it always like we'd be playing, I'd look back there and there's Leroy.
We missed him a lot in there, you know?
Missed him incredibly.
Yeah. We had some times when we could sit down and, you know, listen to the tracks that we had of his, because we had a lot of music. You know, the record starts with him, the record ends with him.
I've heard him play some of his best stuff on this record. And it was weird because, you know, we were in the studio in Seattle last year. You know, nobody knew, you know, we all, you don't think about that. You don't think about leaving this earth, you know, you just want to keep moving forward. So we weren't thinking that. But the way he was playing, it was almost like he knew, you know, it was the weirdest thing. He was like, hey, I'm leaving this for you guys. You guys need to, you know, grab this stuff and step up your game.
You know, for all the bad, there's also those good. And the good thing is that it is his record. He's on the record. And, you know, with any luck, we'll find more tracks of his for records to come.
This is a new song. This song will always belong to Leroy Moore, our good friend, who will always be with us.
Us were just thrashing and it was just noise, you know, because sometimes if you're just trying to be completely spontaneous and honest, just there's just nothing but noise. So we were making this noise and it all just suddenly fell into this perfect groove. So we were just, it's like, and Carter just blasting and everyone just blowing and then it suddenly was like, and it was just a great moment. And Roy fell in love with that. He was always like, what about that thing? We gotta do something with that thing. He was always saying, what about this thing? We need to go back to that, you know? And I never wrote, while he was still alive, I never wrote on top of that. And then Stefan took over his cry.
I had been listening to it, to a previous older version, and I just the music. There were no lyrics or anything. And I came to Dave and was like, we have to work on this. But the day he came to me with his lyrics on top of it, I was like, what'd you just do? I mean, this is awesome. This is so right on. Leroy was in there, and the album title was in the song. And it was a song that we needed on this record.
We'll be drinking. drinking big whiskey while we dance and sing. When my story ends, it's gonna end with him. Heaven or hell, I'm going there with the Ku Klux King.
We all sat, we ate together, we drank wine, you know, and we all had a great time. We talked about the music, you know, and we were there to work and to enjoy what we're all about, you know, and that's making music and being brothers, you know, because it had been a long time since we had gotten a chance to really connect like that. And we reconnected like we did in the old days, you know, in the early days. We got a chance to touch base with that, to reconnect with that. And it brought some good feelings, man. And again, you can hear that in the music.
Don't cry, baby, don't cry.
Charlottesville is a mysterious place. It's a railroad town, for one thing.
Dave would always say there's something about the soil here, and there's something very fertile about it.
I first came down to Charlottesville. I moved down there in the late 80s. There's a lot of great jazz, a lot of great music that was happening in Charlottesville, and a really welcoming music scene.
All the musicians knew each other. A lot of just jamming going on, you know, different people, you know. It's just like Roy would invite me in down to some of his gigs and some of the bands he played, and that's the kind of scene that Charlottesville was, all these different kinds of musicians coming together.
Well, for a kid, it was great, because a lot of the clubs where live music happened were actually restaurants, like Miller's, which is the bar where we all sort of got our start from. It was a restaurant, so a kid like me, 16 years old, could come in, have a cup of coffee and some nachos, and watch like great jazz musicians or folk musicians or rock musicians or whoever it was.
It was a happening scene. So many musicians from all over the world, actually, that had established themselves in Charlottesville and become a part of the community.
The first musician that I ever heard there was Tim Reynolds, that I remember. Tim blew my mind. He was the reason that I went and asked for a job at Miller's. And that's when I heard Leroy, and I heard all this great music happening there.
Leroy, I've known Leroy the longest out of everyone in the band. When I bartended, he used to play at Miller's a lot. He's just an amazing jazz player. And then, as I just said, the first time I ever heard Leroy play, he was leaning, you know, he had a few bourbons, and he was leaning up against the bar, and I was making salads in the back.
I remember meeting Leroy and Carter upstairs. I remember asking them to come upstairs, and I played some of my first tunes for Carter and Leroy upstairs at Miller's. And that's sort of the birthplace of the band.
His style of playing guitar with the way he sang, you know, it just something about it that just clicked.
It's a typical situation in these typical times, but we can't do anything about it.
I remember Leroy and I looking at each other and saying, this guy has something. Let's go ahead and add our two cents and see where we go with this thing.
I think at that time he might have been a waiter, and he just like had this really long hair. You know, we talk casually or whatever, you know, but I didn't really get a chance to know him. I think he went away maybe to South Africa for a while, and he came back, and he had cut off all his hair. And I didn't recognize him at first, you know. And I remember I went down to this club called Tracks one night, and Tim Reynolds, TR3, was playing. And there was this dude on stage that was like, you know, sitting in singing with him. I was like, wow. This guy can sing right here. And I was like, who is this? And I looked closer, and I was like, that's the dude from Miller's.
I had my own band before this, you know, and we've been playing together for about 3 years or so, and that's pretty much, I guess, how Dave kind of knew me.
I think he was shirtless with a brown leather, like, vest with tassels all coming off of it and a big cowboy hat, kind of a sight for a 16-year-old kid.
Well, I'd already known Leroy and Boyd, well, we grew up together.
It was my house, then a house, and then his house. And then five doors up was Boyd. Yeah, the three of us all lived, grew
wow.
up together.
That's funny.
We used to tease Boyd all the time about his violin playing, because he'd be on the porch, it's like, oh!
Stefan didn't know him, but I knew his dad, and I played with his dad for you know, many, many years. And then his dad approached me one day and said, hey, look, you know,
you guys, I hear you're trying to get this band together. Why don't you use my son to play bass?
I was actually, I believe it was the second rehearsal that I sat in on, and I had an upright bass. I didn't know what they were, you know, I didn't know. I was a student, and I was kind of studying upright bass. So I brought my upright, it was horrible. I was trying to play sort of this folky rock, like beat and grooves on top of, with my upright. So I quickly borrowed an electric bass, and the rest is history.
We started rehearsing in Carter's basement, in his mom's basement. Then we started rehearsing in my basement. Carter moved into my basement with me, where I was living, my mom's basement. But we used to rehearse down there. And I remember they were working on one song, I think Tripping Billy's actually was the song.
We were a ball, you were standing underneath us, we were not getting
up. I was writing the tune and the melody at my house, and I called my girlfriend in Africa and I played it for her over the phone. She told me it sounded like Hillbillies on Acid, so I named it that. That's where the name came from.
Roy said we should get someone to play violin on this. Boyd was the person who came through, and he sat in with us a couple times.
I started with classical music, you know, and I studied for about 8 years or so, and I then, you know, just sort of had this idea in my head, you know, about really being in a rock band.
I went there on the first rehearsal, and we just started playing. I was like, oh my God. It's like, oh my God. You know, it's just like, we all, I guess, realized that we had stumbled upon something, you know, that was really cool.
Dave just started putting musicians together that he knew from Miller's, basically, I think, and from around town. And this is who he chose to be in the band, and that's how it started. And they just started doing their little gigs, and it was so powerful and great, and people just really picked up on it.
I met the Dave Matthews Band when I walked into the Bayou in Georgetown in D.C. And I went in there, and within like the first minute, I was floored. I just could not believe what was coming off that stage. Saxophone, fiddle, acoustic guitar, bass and drums. It was something I'd never heard before. I mean, no one had heard it before.
We started playing every Tuesday in a little club called Eastern Standard.
We had like 40 people every Tuesday night come out to see us, you know, and that's how we pretty much started as a band. You know, just playing there for drinks and food and whatnot.
So then we moved to a bigger place called Trax, and we played there every Tuesday. And then pretty shortly, we sold that place out at like 1,000 tickets a week. You know, we'd do little excursions up and down the East Coast.
We'd play any place that would have us. Small clubs, frat houses, street fairs.
We're the Dave Matthews Band. That's definitely the biggest bunch of people we ever collectively stood up in front of.
They'd be playing three shows in a day sometimes. You know, they'd play an outdoor festival, they'd play some sorority, and then play a club later that night.
We did pretty much everything. I think we played at an amusement park, if I'm not mistaken, one time.
We went to Canada once, we went to Toronto, and we went into the lobby of the hotel, and I heard some guy who was in there at the front desk, and he asked the guy behind the front desk, he was like, is there a circus in town? And I turned to BT, I said, he thinks we're in the circus.
The early years with the band were certainly a little more grueling probably back then, all living in a van together.
The van, it was band and crew and equipment.
It was cramped and it was smelly and there were generally people sleeping on top of you. And not in a good way.
Going across country in blizzards to make it to a gig. You know, we never missed a gig. We had a lot of them, you know. So it was, we hit the road, and we hit the road hard.
When we got the van, that was kind of like a big deal. We were like, this is it. We're a band. It was a really amazing time for us. And it was, and musically, playing as much as we played, we really honed in on something.
We were standing in front of the classic red van. This was the main means of transportation for D&B for the first 3 or 4 years, I think.
Just imagine 12 guys sitting in a van after a show, sweaty, stinking, and then on top of that, you add whatever fast food restaurant we stop at, you know, we end up keeping all that stuff in the car.
There was always like little hidden pockets. People had their choice little areas where they would hide food.
Cabbage and broccoli and lettuce and whatever you got in there. And all these things combined start to take its toll as far as the atmosphere.
Sometimes we would go on at midnight. We would finish at 4 a.m. and we would go to a hotel and sleep until 10 or 11. And then we'd proceed to get in a van and drive to the next show. where we would unload, set up, and do it all over again. And we were doing 6-7 shows a week.
The first week of tracks, it would be like 20 people. Then the next week it'd be 40. It doubled every week. I mean, just the growth of it was phenomenal.
What would you say?
People started taping our music. Then we'd start going to towns we'd never been to before, and kids would all be singing the music.
The first time the band ever went to Boulder, Colorado and played the Fox Theater, all these kids were there singing, and the band couldn't figure out why. And it's because the tapes were being traded. And what was such a smart move is Corn Capshaw, the band's manager, would have them play where in places where he knew college kids congregated over the holidays, whether that's Christmas break, spring break, summer, whatever. He knew he was reaching more than just Chapel Hill, North Carolina at the right time. He was reaching all these college kids that would then go back and spread it through the dorms and whatnot. And that's why the band grew.
It certainly wasn't radio or anything like that. It was definitely homemade tapes. There was no digital access to us at that stage. It was back in the dark ages.
It was so unique in the time that the band broke. It was in the time of Nirvana and Pearl Jam and Seattle and grunge. There was no electric guitar, there was a violin, there was a saxophone. But yet the power from the stage was always there.
The energy in the crowd, the energy of all the fans, just was infectious.
Lights down, you have a
got crazy really quickly.
It just resonated with me. Because I wasn't thinking like a record executive, I was thinking like a fan, I just got caught up in the moment.
After we were signed, we recorded our own sort of half live, half studio album called Remember Two Things.
Basically our album that we made, and you know, it was kind of like thing, we're basically selling out of the back of the trunk.
Going into the next chapter, I remember driving around the Virginia countryside with Dave and thinking like, well, who would be the right guy to make their RCA debut? There was one name that kept on coming up, and we kept on listening to all these records, and Steve Lillywhite's name was on the back of all those records.
Steve was the guy that came out and without any hesitation said, I know exactly what to do with this band. I know exactly how to record what they are on stage.
I got sent a copy of their independent record, Remember Two Things, and I remember vividly sitting in the front room, putting the CD on, and it starts with the song Ants Marching, with just a snare drum, and a snare drum, and a snare drum, and this snare drum just keeps going. Every time the snare drum hit, I went, okay, this is getting more ridiculous. Something's gonna happen. It was a fantastic feeling when the band came in, and I went, this is brilliant. I love this band, I love this song, and I was sold, and I thought, I have to see this band. They flew me over to New York, and I went to see them at Irving Plaza, and this gig was just fantastic. I just had this white light moment. I had this feeling that this band, I was the guy for them.
He had done so much. He was the first producer that I'd ever met to have his type background.
I love the work that he did with Peter Gabriel and the work that he did with U2. He has a great ear for sound, and I think that he made magic happen with the music that we had at that time.
Under the Table and Dreaming, we recorded that. We were at Bearsville, New York, which is up in Woodstock.
Being there in the spring helped add to this sort of joyful feeling that we were having up there. And everything was so new and so exciting.
We recorded mostly in this barn. Steve was very much into vibe, you know what I mean? Just low lights and candles and incense.
There were a lot of things about that recording experience that were amazing. It's hard to keep that. You can't ever, you know, it's probably like the first time you kiss someone because you can't ever have it again. To go into this great big studio and those big reels of tape, it really felt like the real thing.
I didn't want it to go completely over the top on the first album because, for a start, we were using acoustic guitars and I had this idea that having two acoustic guitars, this would be the way of retaining what the band were. They said they had this guitar player called Tim Reynolds. They wanted to come and do some overdubs on the record. And I said, well, having seen them, I felt that it would be great to have Tim there from the beginning.
We were all so wide-eyed and also excited about everything and so eager. It was a really exciting time.
When everyone's having fun doing it, you know, it's the way you want every record to feel. Every record can't feel that way, but the fact that the first one did, good memories.
Yeah.
Under the Table and Dreaming is a beautiful album because I feel that everything was right at the right time and the stars aligned themselves.
The industry still didn't have a grasp on what the band was. They still didn't know where to put them. You know, yeah, they're playing, but they're kind of that jam band thing. They really don't play songs, which is such a misnomer. Because if this band does anything, it's the fact that they write great songs.
I started getting word that this album was doing well, and then I got phoned up by Pete Robinson again, saying, would you like to do the second album? And I went, yes, I would love to. We've got the same studio booked, and I felt that that was good for a second time. I did feel we had to change things. Second album, I thought, okay, the band had a bit of a swagger. I wanted to translate that swagger into a more muscular, meaty record. Leroy, for instance, I was talking to him about, you know, what can we do to help with this sound? And he said, well, I could get a baritone sax. And a baritone sax is this enormous, big, honking thing. And I said, yes, fantastic.
When we went back to do Crash, we had a lot of music still for that album. And then I was writing quite a bit. The song Crash was new. Yeah, I've been messing around with the idea of that song for parts of it. But the bulk of that song is most certainly inspired by the love of my life, which is my wife.
Crash into me, yeah, baby. They're coming to you.
Crash was special. We also, you know, we recorded also in that barn, you know, in that same studio. And, you know, it was only our second album.
The second albums are very often the most difficult ones. And I think we succeeded in coming out with a good slap to the critics.
Second albums are where you trip up. You have the big first album. Very few artists, second album outsells the first album. That happens very rarely. With Dave Matthews Band, it did. You know, I think Crash is their biggest selling album still.
Before this crowd of streets, we're in Sausalito, California, just across the Golden Gate. Really nice studio called The Plant.
Being a new place in a new town, it was wonderful. I love working in the studio. So to get to go to a new studio and experience, you know, new people and got to meet great people out in San Francisco and that area and learn about that music scene and that history with that studio, with Fleetwood Mac, recorded Rumors there, and that alone was enough to get me excited.
This is the record where they felt like they could definitely take some artistic chances. Don't Drink the Water, you know, was the first single from that record, which I always thought was a great statement. You know, there were songs like Crush and Stay, and but Don't Drink the Water was like this, you know, Peter Gabriel anthem, which is, you know, something you didn't hear a lot of.
I still felt I had something, I had more to give. Maybe my big idea for this record was, let's get some guests in. Alanis Morissette, the Kronos Quartet, the ladies on Stay, for instance. Dave had this idea that he loved little snippets of music, almost like commercials between the songs. We recorded maybe half a dozen little 30-second musical interludes.
And that was a lot of fun, to work on something knowing that it was just gonna be like a couple seconds.
The best way to get a groove for songs is to actually just sit down and start playing.
Freaks. every single one of us is a freak.
That was good fun. Dave had a lot of lyrics to write for that album.
We had to build all the songs from Before These Crowded Streets from scratch because we had played all the stuff that we had done on Under the Table and Crash.
That, my brother was nice when you just sung it there.
God, that was cool. I can't back.
So you mean let it blossom?
Yeah.
It was funny, there was one song that Don't Drink the Water.
Don't drink the water. Don't drink the water.
And we were trying to record it, and none of us were getting along, and none of us were speaking our minds. We basically left the studio cursing, like, forget about this song, very disappointed, very angry. I think I went out and drowned my sorrows. And then we came back in the morning, and Steve said, I was surprised, because we came back in this morning and listened to this recording, and that turned out to be the recording for Don't Drink the Water, and it ended up being an amazing recording. The band was, we were still together strongly, but and we still had joyful times, but there were a lot more miles under our tires and a lot more time together. So our patience with each other was at that stage wearing a lot thinner.
I think they'd been working really hard. There was a little bit of burnout factor. Under the Table and Dreaming was exactly that. It was a dreamy record. It was pristine and nice. And Crash was more of the muscular record. Before These Crowded Streets was a darker record. It's almost like the clouds were starting to appear. It was still sunny, but the clouds were starting to appear in the scene, you know.
Listen, well, welcome back to Philadelphia. I mean, you were here during the summer, now you're back for a couple more shows for Max. It's like you non-stop touring, though.
Well, we're out all quite a lot. This is a pretty long tour since April, and Tim and I go out for a little, you know, when we have time off, but the focus is the band.
Made great music before, and I think that our early records, 1, 2, 3, were really, they're part of something. We started to get lost shortly after that.
We went to record our fourth studio record with Lily White. We never really thought about using anyone else.
The band said they wanted to do it at their own studio in Charlottesville. It's very different recording in your hometown. When you go away, you're going away to make a record. When you're recording in your hometown, you're going to work.
Instead of finding a unique place, we found a sort of a big building.
It was dark and the ceilings were low and it was a beautiful summer and we were inside in this windowless cave. Everyone's relationship with each other and our relationship with Steve really didn't prosper there.
I think at that time, just became hard on everybody.
The vibe was not very good because Dave had to dig into his soul and what was coming out was very interesting.
After about 6 months, we had to go back on the road and we didn't really have anything to show for it.
Seeing the way this album was going, which was further into a dark place, instead of coming to me and saying, look, Steve, you know this band better than anyone else. Can we turn this to a different way? You know, can we steer it? It wasn't done. And there was a sense of, you know, something has to happen.
In the end, the way to get out of that was just to move away from the whole thing, including Lily White.
When we stopped recording in June, we were all ready to come back after their tour. But then I was told, no, I'm off. And it was like a brick to my head.
Those last sessions we did with Steve, the CD of it was leaked, called the Lily White Sessions.
The version that was leaked to Napster, I don't know who did it. There were literally only five CDs made, and I still have mine.
You never want anything of yours that you didn't want to be released to be released.
And subsequently, when it was leaked, a lot of people really liked it. I felt embarrassed because I hadn't finished it.
At that stage, we were done with each other in a way, and rightly or wrongly, Lily White received a lot of the wrath because we didn't aim it all at each other.
Times did become hard, and there were times, to be honest, when Dave was ready to throw in the towel. I said, look, being in a band, you know, and having a band is the thing that you'll be remembered for. I took them on a journey. We had this great journey. I mean, we ended up crashing, but there you go.
Oh, when the world ends, collect your things, you're coming with me. When the world ends.
As far as moving on and moving ahead, I think that after 6 months, I was open to anything.
We left that unfinished, it was leaked, but we'd already planned to go and try an album with someone new, so we went and worked with Glenn Ballard.
The idea was that Dave was gonna come out and write three songs with me, and quite honestly, something else happened. We wrote 12 songs. We wrote 12 songs in 10 days. So we sat here and played the demos of the 12 songs for the band in this room, and the guy said, my God, that's amazing. When the world ends, when the world ends. I just wanted to be part of the band, first of all, and maybe the music director for 5 minutes. I think they were just like, can somebody else be like the coach for a second? So that was enter Glenn Ballard.
There was a decision to bring in Glenn Ballard, who was mostly a pop producer, which is different from us. In this case, you know, it was pretty much everything was written and laid out for us before we got to the studio, you know, which was really different to just sort of play parts that are written.
It was necessarily the most different, probably, approach they've ever had. But that's the way we had to do it. It was either that or this record wasn't going to happen.
And I think it's a great record, but it didn't have the chemistry that those early albums did. It had lost that for sure.
Glenn certainly taught Dave the art of writing songs and the joy of writing songs. I think people look at that record and go, well, how could it be good? It happened so fast. I think that's why it is good.
I think that each album we made were really different from anything else that was happening around that time. And then I think every day sort of made us turn more toward what was happening in music around then, made us more like other stuff. Back in to record some of the stuff that we hadn't finished from the Lily White Sessions. And it was a good record called Busted Stuff. Pretty good. But again, it was sort of in the shadow of something that the fans really loved, which was the Lily White Sessions. And some of the fans really didn't like Every Day, which was a result of the Glenn Ballard thing. But it had, but at least for radio, that had been our most successful to that point. We came back together to work with Mark Batson on Stand Up. We all really liked him, and we liked how musical he was.
I think that Stand Up was us reaching as far as we could to try and see if we can make a record in a different formula than we've ever done before.
Every Day should have been the Dave Matthews Band featuring Glenn Ballard. And I feel like the same as Stand Up, it should have been the Dave Matthews Band featuring Mark Batson.
That was sort of the change in what was happening musically and with the guys in the band. And we became a little more distant from each other. And the music that was once really easy to make with each other started to become difficult.
The way we look at each other on stage or how we treat each other when we're passing in the hallway is not honest and open. A lot of unsaid stuff is an amazing, destructive thing. You're just, you know, just tired of putting up with each other.
I sort of threw my arms up and said, I can't take it. I can't deal with the band anymore. You know, it's just, we're unhappy. Unless we can find a way to actually be together, I don't want to just be together for no reason, so we can wither.
We didn't hit the bottom, but we saw the bottom. And the bottom meant no more band, and no more band making no more music, and having to all of a sudden only having what we had done be our legacy.
I remember Roy coming to me in Charlottesville when we were starting to work on what was gonna be this next album, 3 years ago, 3.5 years ago. And Roy said, man, you gotta lead this band, bro. If you don't lead this band, we're not going anywhere. We can't get out of this. And I said, I can't lead this band, man. This band is done, you know? I mean, at the moment that we were all gonna slam the doors closed and not communicate anymore, that for whatever reason, everyone just sort of lined up for one last, you know, sort of greeting. And then it just started working really hard on getting better.
Seeing the bottom sort of brought us together and made us realize that we love each other. We're all family, we're all brothers. We're all in this together. We have so much more to give. Just to let it all go and throw it away because we're having a hard time communicating with each other or we have a hard time understanding each other. We realized it wasn't worth it.
And out of that came this new explosiveness and sort of unapologetic way we were playing. And the acknowledgement that although we made some good records like Every Day and Busted Stuff and Stand Up, that those were not the band at its best.
At that moment, things started getting better and we started really coming together as a band. How do we want to make this next record? Not about how the record company wants to make it, not about how a producer wants to make it, but how do we as a band want to make this next record? We've had so many ups and downs in this band, but we were at an all-time high during last year. Before the summer tour, we were in the studio and we were all together in a room and everyone's laughing, having a good time, interjecting what they thought.
You know, that's the one that I was talking about, man. That's what I think about some of the tunes so far. And some of these are gonna be so whack live, I can't wait.
Mm. I worked a lot harder on this record than I worked on, I think, any of our records ever. We gave each other sort of a mandate, you know? Everything, put everything you have in this record. This is all of us, you know? Music by the Dave Matthews Band. The only really sad thing about this record is that Roy wasn't here for it. But it don't always work out. Just cry, cry, baby, if we must. But just remember, I love the way you love me, girl. And I love the way you.
Charlottesville music fans are continuing to remember Dave Matthews Band saxophonist Leroy Moore. Moore died yesterday in Los Angeles of complications stemming from his June ATV accident.
We want to just tell you all that we had some bad news today due to some complications. Since some injuries he received a little earlier this summer, our good friend Leroy Moore passed on and gave his ghost up today, and we will miss him forever.
Roy was going to check on something in his property, and he was driving an ATV across a field. He hit a ditch that was covered by grass. It was cut out by some truck that got caught in the mud during the rain. It broke him up pretty badly. I guess what had happened, he wanted to go and be in his house in Los Angeles and do his rehab there. But it was just right at that first moment that he got back there after coming from Virginia and going there, that a clot of some sort had gotten past the filtering system that they had inside him to stop it, and that's what killed him. Everyone was shocked. We all thought he was gonna fully recover.
When I got the call in the morning, it took a few seconds, and I turned around, I went and told my wife, and that was where, like, you know, the floodgates opened, and I really realized what had happened, and it was just so surreal for the rest of the day.
It was real hard on Carter. It was hard on all of us, but, you know, Carter knew Roy since they were little kids.
There are times when I'm at home, you know, I said, man, I'll think of some kind of riff or something, and I'll say, oh, man, let me call Leroy, and I'll have to catch myself, you know, put the phone down because he's not there.
He's really one of my best friends. He was just a funny, funny guy, and just like had a lot of love and so much to offer, so talented. I mean, a saxophone sound. He's really one of my favorite saxophone players, and I'd say one of my favorite musicians, because he just brought stuff from the depths of his heart.
He was such a warm person. He could turn and smile at you, and the smile would make you melt.
I think about him every single day. He would give you the shirt off his back. That's what I loved about him. Just a beautiful, beautiful young man.
Roy was one of the most special people that I ever met in my life, and it's a big thing to leave such a mark inside someone. He wasn't an easy person either, you know. He could tell a good story, but he could also be kind of grim sometimes. But it's funny how when someone goes away, what they leave behind is however bright the light they shone while they were living, and then all the other things kind of turn to dust. So in my mind right now, he kind of looks like an angel.
To a room, and if everybody might be a little bit down or grumpy about something or whatever, he would come in and start joking around with them instantly, and suddenly get everybody laughing. He had just this way of completely cheering up a room.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's Saxophone Boy! Saxophone Boy!
Why is Snoop Dogg's clothes always so clean? Because he uses biatch.
Damn.
Roy is really a complicated person, but incredibly loving and incredibly beautiful guy. so unselfish when he plays. It's so absolutely not about him. In a really different way from any other musician I've ever heard. He plays as if he's not there. Blows his ass off on the heavy tunes, but in the quieter tunes, when you can hear him whisper, that just blows my mind.
Lost like a comrade, but at his best, you know. So that's really cool. That's a great thing to be able to say.
True to himself. He wasn't trying to be anyone else when he'd play. It was just him coming out through his horn.
He had taken everything that he had learned from the great jazz guys and turned it into his style.
He's like, if it doesn't feel safe, he's like, that's probably the idea you should go with. He was a daredevil, man. He would dare to try things that weren't the norm, you know, and I really appreciate being around him for that fearlessness to just put an idea out there and let it develop.
I don't think the music world realizes how much of a loss it was, because he was a genius.
This song is called Seven.
I say this about every song, every single song on this record. That's my favorite song. No, that's my favorite song. You know, every song I hear is my favorite song. But this one, this particular song, Seven, is one. It had another title to it at first, you know, in the beginning, but we switched it because I think Dave got another idea, you know, lyric-wise.
Feeling a lot better than I did a sound check. I was just so... And I'm still a little, but I'm a lot better, you know. It's just, you know, it's hard to make those transitions like that, you know. Well, at one time it was called Garden Hose, but now it's called Seven. But it's a bad mofo.
I think we change the name again.
Okay, so hit the root of that.
Red is the color
of the sun. With my eyes closed, I can still taste you, and I will again.
Even if you did the
red is the color,
Oh, red is the color.
Right.
Of the, even if, once we get to, you know, that word sun.
Right.
If you split there.
There, yeah,
because
yeah.
By the time we sing it, you already have it in your ear.
Yeah.
It's just so fun to take up something that's really complex musical statement, but if you can deliver it in a real honest celebration, this is how it goes, this beautiful music, then people hear it, and then they can hear all that, and it's not clever.
Right,
it's not a clever song.
Right,
it's
genius.
Red is the color of the sun with my eyes closed.
That's the one that throws me off. Yeah. That one. That's the one that's stuck in my head, and I'm like, ah!
That's good, though. Oh. You can sing that. Sing whatever the you want.
No! Don't tell me that! Don't do that!
I'm gonna sing whatever the I want.
But yours sound right, though. I'd be like Elmer Fudd, man. Be hunting that. Where is that note?
And I keep taking it away. Red is the color of the sun with my eyes.
Oh, man.
Great.
One note. Yeah.
That'd be doing it, man.
That's like so.
Funny twists and turns, goes in and out, but it just a beautiful arc of a song. I challenge almost any band to make it swing. It's like a pendulum, the way that swing, that song swings. Just like a pendulum.
Red is the color of the sun with my eyes closed. I can still taste you.
Tune is blowing up over the web. Everybody's talking about that tune.
From when we played the other night?
The first night we played it, yeah.
That's last night
it,
you
hit. Last night, it hit hard, real hard. Yeah. It's burning on the internet right now.
We knew we needed to make a band record. It had to be something that all of us had our hands in.
Doesn't have to be your style, but I'm willing to bet that the style of music you listen to is well represented on this record, because it's diverse too.
There's no doubt in my mind that the Dave Matthews Band fan who's been with the band from day one, they're just gonna go, oh, this is it. I knew they had this in them. I knew this was the record they were gonna make.
Once we started writing, once we started working together, our ideas were flowing, but also everyone's ears were open to what everyone else was saying, and that was so important for this whole project.
Then we could build it up so it's crazy, and then we could slam it closed and go into like that violin and saxophone thing with it. We knew we had something that was like nothing else, but it's real concise, you know? That doesn't mean there's not moments of improvisation, absolute improvisation. It starts with it and it ends with it. And then there's moments in it that you have the big piece of granite and just. It starts real close and real personal, and then it just slaps you right across the face. How you doing? I can play the record or just punch you right in the nose. Grux was a nickname that Roy had for Carter, and Carter had for Roy, and Roy and Carter had for Tim. They all called each other Grux. And it was a name they sort of had for each other, well, for what they did together, when they played music together, when they were young. When I met Roy, I spelled his name. I knew it was Roy, I knew it was Leroy, but I spelled it with a Y, and he said, it's not with a Y, it's with an I, like the king. So when we were talking about making the album, we thought Groove Grux King was it had a good vibe.
Heaven or hell, I'm going there with the Groove Grux King.
And then we were out doing a photo shoot, and this guy came stumbling down the street drunk, playing a harmonica, really good playing a harmonica. And he said, I need a big whiskey, and he'd play for people and he'd give him some change. I walked up to the guy and I handed him a 20, and I don't think he saw what it was at first. He said, I need a, oh, that is a big whiskey. And Rashawn leant over and said, that's a good name for an album, Big Whiskey.
We'll be drinking big whiskey while we dance and sing.
And that's probably, hopefully, what people will end up calling this album.
But I like as a full name, Big Whiskey and the Gru Grux King, because it sounds like a fairy tale. Like a fairy tale from New Orleans, which was where we made this album, and it's a great city.
And it reminds me of Roy, because he also liked the Big Whiskey.
Out of my head, I'm into the room. So when my ghost takes me from you, you can't remember the fool that I am. Don't cry, baby, don't cry.
I think there is a tribute feel to LeRoy in a lot of ways. I think it's reflected in some of the lyrics, and certainly it's reflected in the artwork.
I thought of my favorite album covers and how you could stare at them for a while you listen to music. And then I thought I'd give a run at scribbling some ideas. The alligator pie, snake in the woodpile. Nice. I haven't drawn in a long time, so I wasn't sure how it turned out. But I think it turned out fine. At least it can be entertaining while people are listening to the record if you don't have anything else to look at.
That looked like Roy.
I know, kind of. I did one that looked too much like Roy, and when I drew it, and he wasn't as like that, yeah. But it does kind of look like him, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Records.
In California, was cool. Earthquake.
Boy, I hope it doesn't look.
Whoa!
Oh, cool.
This is the fancy one.
Yeah. Ooh. Look at that dude. He's trippy. But maybe there's more in.
There better be more.
Wow, that looks amazing.
It looks good. Oh, here, here.
So cool.
Donkey face boy. Mm.
This is horrifying in a way.
Yeah, I know.
It's really creepy.
Yeah, he's most creepy. Rabbits are creepy.
And this
and
is the
donkey's
face.
Donkey faced.
This is great.
Yeah, it's cool.
So
man.
Into it. Oh, look at that.
That's the cover. It's cool.
Oh, I want to get some of these. I want to get each one of these blown up.
They're going to have, like, oh, I think every page, they're going to have in here a little photo book of Roy. Mm. And there's going to be the DVD, and then the CD, and the extra CD. Uh-huh. And then there's going to be a book. Photo book of all of us, and then all those posters. These.
Is this a font, or did you actually
hand wrote everything?
Really?
Yeah. You can see where I ran out of pen. Change pen. Oh, wrong pen. Ran it back to the other pen.
That's some pretty neat handwriting you got there.
I always make up lyrics.
Good.
And then people get attached to versions of the lyrics that I made up on the spot live. Like, there's a song that people ask for all the time called Number 40, which I've never, ever written lyrics for. But apparently there's a version out there that is the one that everyone likes. But the thing is, that's unfair, is that then more people want me to play it. But I don't know it, and I never knew it. So people, why don't you do it? I don't know it!
I didn't
know. I've never heard it before. I don't know what the lyrics are. I never knew what they were.
Just popped out of you one night.
They were just bleh. Mm. You know? I know it goes. That's what I know the music for it. Mm. That's it. Same old thing I do all the time.
Dave, as a man, absolutely unique. There's nobody like this guy. If you ever get to spend time with him, you'll discover that he is hilarious.
Touch me.
If I had a painting that looked exactly like this, like you two guys and those two guys,
like us both looking at it.
Yeah, yeah, and then this whole thing, that'd be an awesome painting.
As a writer, God, he's probably my favorite or one of my favorites. He's just absolutely intense on pushing the envelope, doing something new, finding great grooves.
I can't remember what the arrangement was or anything, so.
All right.
And the music's gonna come out of?
All the rest of the guitar. Because he's from South Africa and from other parts of the world, he has a different musical experience that makes him think a little differently.
I have very limited guitar skills, but I think I've exploited my limitations as well as possible, as well as could be expected.
Oh, that's a nice cue.
Do you hate this song?
Some of his main influences were these great South African, you know, keyboard players, but he had a guitar, so he was like, how do I get these rhythms, these South African rhythms, into my pop songs? That the fact that there's this amazing mix of sound and soul and groove that he's constantly striving for makes him absolutely one of a kind.
Also, he's not that far off, is he?
Dougie and Robbie. Are you already becoming impatient with me? What are you, out of your mind? What are you insane? I can't believe you're sitting there looking at me like, well, okay, let's finish this song, get on with something else.
Yeah, it goes to this B.
Yes, Commandant.
You're very sensitive.
My hand will be broken by the end of this.
You're gonna be in the middle of chorus one.
I like this section.
Second, that can end, obviously, we're gonna fade. We can't do that forever, because that'll drive any reasonable citizen insane. And then we're gonna cut the rest of it up shorter, too. So should I do another acoustic, or do you think you have it more or less?
We got it.
I think this song could be interesting if I put my magic on it.
How much of this are we doing tomorrow? Some or none?
We can do a little bit here.
You here? Yeah, I mean, I don't know. You're...
I have to sound check at four. So I'm gonna try it on that little f-ing griffin. See what happens if you all don't mind.
I like that little like stuff that Tim's playing on it. It's really cool, like during the workflow.
I can't even count how many shows I've seen. I've been working with the band since 1992-ish. I've never seen the same show, ever. There's always something new and fresh that happens.
Fenton Williams, I'm the lighting director for the band.
Ian Kuhn, I do the sound that the band hears on stage. I'm the monitor guy.
My name's Darryl. The band calls me G. More importantly, I'm in charge of personal security. I take care of these guys. It's my job to make sure that they go home the same way that they got here.
My name's Jeff Trump. I've been tour accountant with the band since 1995. In 1999, we came up with a plan to try and provide tickets to our fan base directly instead of having to get the tickets from the venues.
I think we're still one of the few artists that print their own tickets and handle such a large amount of fan club without using the venue's traditional ticketing system.
Our fans get in the front row. We get real excitement up front, and some of us who've seen the band 1,000 times, a little farther back where we can still enjoy.
My name's Alex. I'm the merchandiser for the band. I look after all the stuff that you see at a show, be it t-shirts and hats and that kind of thing.
This is the 2009 spring tour line. There's one constant though, and that is the white Fire Dancer shirt. It's in its 15th year. We probably sold 300,000 Fire Dancer shirts.
I came into it at such a young age. I was 18 at the time. I was really just thinking about audio. I wasn't worried about getting paid for it, and I think that really helped me get the job.
I've been here 10 years. I've known them 12, and I love every single day of it.
Somewhere right around 17 or 18 years that I've been working with them.
Summer number 14.
I've been with the band for 17 years now, and they keep getting better. Carter keeps getting stronger and faster.
I started working for the band in 1993 when they were still a little bar band, and we used to travel to shows in Dave's station wagon.
Keeping up with these guys was the big challenge. Every time you turned around, we were going from frat party to a national club act to playing arenas to stadiums. Instead of just looking and stacking the speakers and eyeballing things, we're getting blueprints of a venue and using protractors to design an audio system.
Usually hang out right behind the horns in the darkness, and when Roy was around, he rocked hard, and I would step right into the light and just pop him one time, just to let him know that's how you rock the house.
So our first band and crew photo had maybe 30 people in it, and it included the entire opening act and their crew. That was 95, and Dion Ferris was out with us. Nowadays, there's probably over 100, 110 people part of the whole thing, including the band. It's unbelievable the way it's grown.
When I started, I was kind of the core fan base. I was a college student. Those fans have grown up with the band, and now it's gotten to the point where people are coming with their kids, bringing a whole new generation into the thing.
We all have kids ourselves now. I have three boys myself. Dave has identical twin girls. I have identical twin boys, so chances of that on one tour are pretty slim, I would think.
You know, we've got the family at home. We come together, and we have a family out here that's really tight, and the family at home is always welcome out here, and it's the band members' kids and our kids, and everybody gets together really well.
This band has touched people more than just a good time on a Friday night, and that's powerful.
We're all thanking our lucky stars to have come together to be part of this. The band probably feels exactly the same way. It's a really special thing, you know. It's why it's lasted so long, and there's no end in sight.
What's wrong with you? You're unbelievable. That was one of the high points of my entire life.
Because of the camaraderie, that means everything to me. Just to share feelings and to share, you know, vibes and to share great energy together again.
That's what about this band. That's a joyful band. I mean, we're a joyful band. But, you know, this record, it doesn't deal with a lot of real happy stuff. The last song on the record is the one song that is really hopeful. Right. The other songs, this is a dark train ride, but it is joyful.
It's joyful. Know? When things are right and when you got things, you know, when the communication and all that stuff is happening the way it should be, you can do anything you want. I mean, the sky's the limit.
It's coming together over the music. It's just like the ability just to laugh and not to take everything so seriously. That's made us last for 18 years.
This band's a good marriage. There's been moments of question as to if we all had it in us to keep going. You know, the music always sort of overrides any question mark we might have.
And it hit up. You guys hit it tonight. Stop your foot. And then you did it, and I was made joy.
Everything was nearly falling apart. You know, I think we're all doing a good job honoring Roy's memory, I think. We don't have to be perfect to each other. We don't have to care about the same things except the music, because that says more for what we are than anything else, if we can make music together, real music together.
Oh, I'll see you all out in about 3 minutes.
Sounds good. Damn!
Spicy chicken wings, who's down with that? I had like a mocha, or soy mocha. Can you do a soy mocha, is that weird?
We had them yesterday.
Oh, really? I'm gonna get spicy chicken wings.
May I have a quad? Thank you. Soy mocha.
God, does that sound so wet farty?
That sounds like it could make a wet farty.
Look, I'm not allowed to talk to you because you're the cameraman.
I don't just talk to the camera all the time.
Right. Does this seem natural? Everybody. Do I seem natural in your face?
Where are you now?
People that are watching Fuse television.